I'm Leslie Berlowitz, and as president of the Academy, it is my pleasure to call together the 1975th stated meeting of the American Academy of Arts and Sciences. It's wonderful to be back on the Stanford campus, and we will be back again on December 7th when we're going to have a symposium on the military that David Kennedy is going to be the moderator of. And I'm pleased that so many of you are here, and I look forward to seeing you again then. I want to begin by acknowledging the passing of John McCarty, president, professor of computer science, and a pioneer in the field of artificial intelligence. In fact, Professor McCarthy is credited with coining the term artificial intelligence. He was elected a fellow of the American Academy in 1974, and we were honored by his membership and sad to note his passing. Earlier this month, the Academy held its annual induction ceremony in Cambridge. I am pleased that several members of the Stanford faculty are among the class of 2011. And a little inside business, because I know not all of you are members of the Academy, but those of you who are, I encourage you to nominate promising younger colleagues and to remember to vote, because it's only through the nomination and voting process that we can continue to elect really distinguished new generation of members. During our three-day induction weekend, new fellows had an opportunity to learn about the Academy's programs of independent policy research. As many of you know, our studies focus on science and technology policy, including arms control, social policy and American institutions, the humanities, education, and the topic of today's program, energy and global security. Many people are not really that familiar with the American Academy as a research institute and think more of its role as an honorary society. But when the Academy was created by John Adams, and he got George Washington and Benjamin Franklin and a few others together to work together, it wasn't really that he wrote a note to George Washington and said, I want to elect you to an honorary society. What he was saying was the country needed really thoughtful, highly qualified individuals who were original in their thinking to come together to solve some of the problems of the new nation and to foresee some of the problems that the nation was going to have. And that's really the mission of the Academy, to bring very able people together, along with others who are expert in the field, to worry about long-term problems for the country in an independent way. And by that I mean not ideology. Everybody has its own ideology. But to try to bring together and weigh those ideologies and find common ground. And I think the country needs to find common ground, whatever your belief system is. And that goal of the founders of the Academy and of our current membership is as important as ever. Just a year ago, the Academy joined with the Center for International Security and Cooperation here at Stanford to assess game-changing events that would fundamentally alter the future of nuclear energy as part of a now three-year ongoing project to think hard about nuclear energy and the possibility of international cooperation and collaboration as part of its agenda. The Academy convened for that meeting officials from government, industry, the national labs, academia, many of whom are here with us again in these 2 days when we're looking at the after effects of Fukushima. The group discussed game changers that could result from innovations in the fuel cycle and in reactor designs, from military attacks or terrorism, and they considered the potential impact of a catastrophic accident. 6.5 months later, after that meeting, the earthquake and tsunami crippled the Fukushima nuclear context and had worldwide impact on nuclear energy deployment. The Game Changers Conference and subsequent report are part of our overall initiatives work. The project brings together constituencies that historically have rarely communicated with each other, policymakers and the heads of non-governmental organizations, nuclear engineers and industry leaders, representative from the national labs, social scientists, and academia, and technical experts. And every once in a while, they even let in an English major like me. I suppose my role is to make sure the commas are in the right place. Nuclear energy has long been a concern of the Academy. One of the earliest volumes of our journal, Dædalus, was a 1960 special issue that helped fashion an intellectual framework for the fledgling area of nuclear arms control. Last year, we published two anniversary volumes on the global nuclear future, edited by Stephen Miller and Scott Sagan, which explored nuclear energy and security in the U.S. and abroad. Scott and Steve are the distinguished leaders of our current ongoing project. The Academy's work is really a behind-the-scenes activity. We are generating policy recommendations that balance the growing global appetite for nuclear power with the need to enhance safety and strengthen the nuclear nonproliferation regime. We do this through scholarship and by fostering behind-the-scenes dialogue between international leaders and key stakeholders, many of whom are here with us this weekend. We have sponsored regional summits in the Middle East and in Southeast Asia, and we plan to continue that work and do so again in the coming 2 years. We organized a meeting of delegates to the 2010 NPT Review Conference that helped to crystallize key principles that were ultimately part of the final report. And I am so pleased that Ambassador Libran Kaptalan, the president of the NPT Review Conference in 2010, is here with us. Along with three previous conference presidents, Diantha Dhanapalo, Mohammed Shakur, and Sergio Duarte, to have all of your expertise as we consider both the technical and the political futures of nuclear power, even after a defining accident. It really, I think, speaks to the kind of work that we're trying to advance. We're looking for a collaboration that really has no borders and it stretches beyond local interests, because any accident is an accident for all of us. And as human beings, we all live on this fragile planet trying to work together. I want to acknowledge the generous support of the William and Flora Hewlett Foundation, the Alfred P. Sloan Foundation, the Carnegie Corporation of New York, and the Kavli Foundation that has helped us advance the work. And I am also pleased to tell you that several program officers who work with leading preeminent institutions in the area of nuclear security have joined with us tonight. And I'd like to recognize Ted Greenwood, Carl Robichaud, Megan Garcia, and Emma Belcher in this context. A number of leading figures advise our work, including George Shultz, Sam Nunn, Richard Meserve, and Sid Drell from this country, as well as Sergio Duarte from Brazil, Mohammed Shakur from Egypt, and the distinguished members of our panel, among others. But most of all, I am grateful to the leadership of Scott Sagan of Stanford University, Stephen Miller from Harvard University, Robert Rosner of the University of Chicago, and Stephen Goldberg of Argonne National Laboratory. If I've gone through a lot of names, it's mostly to show you the quality and expansion of the expanse of people who are contributing to the work and their diversity. And I also want to thank Sig Hecker for his advice as we've grappled with some of the Southeast Asia issues, and I guess I could go around the room and recognize people in every row, so I will stop now because I'm going to get into big trouble if I keep this up. For those of you I didn't mention, my apologies, but thank you. Tonight we will hear global experts on global nuclear future in light of the accident at Fukushima. To introduce the panel, it is my great pleasure to introduce the now retired head of CSAC, but not the retired professor. In fact, it is our hope that his official duties at CSAC, he keeps reminding us that this was not a roast, but rather just a change in emphasis in his career, that it gives him even more time to guide us in our work at the Academy. The Academy depends on volunteers who spend time helping us shape problems that we address, and Scott has been a wonderful collaborator, and along with Steve and I personally, who try to be on their weekly phone calls, learn so much from them. Imagine I started off not knowing the difference between safety and security, but I've learned a little bit. Scott is the Carolyn S. G. Monroe Professor of Political Science at Stanford, a senior fellow of the Freeman Spogli Institute, and co-director emeritus of the Center for International Security and Cooperation. Before joining Stanford, he was a lecturer in the Department of Government at Harvard University and served as special assistant to the director of the Organization of the Joint Chiefs of Staff at the Pentagon. He was elected a fellow in 2008, and we at the Academy have kept him very busy ever since. With his wealth of knowledge, his expertise, and his gentle but decisive leadership, we are all grateful to him, and he will now introduce the panel.